So you're just back from Italy. You mentioned that you were at a meeting with did you say the chairman of the IPCC?
The meeting was called by the papal Pontifical Academy of Sciences, that's okay. The Vatican Science Group, and by the Italian government lab, CNR. And so it's just one of the people there was the chairman of IPCC.
And you were talking about, one of the subject matters was something we haven't talked about yet, the global sea level rises. So that obviously not an insignificant factor in global warming either. So what's the prognosis for that with the various temperature rises that we are likely to get?
Well, the prognosis, as in most things, seems to be acceleration. Everything is all the bad things are accelerating. And the sea level rise is again one of those bad things. It's accelerating and it's been underplayed by IPCC. And again, you can see why. You can say it's for cowardly political reasons, because if you under predict how much sea level is going to rise, then in the summary for policymakers, then the policymakers can take a lower value for the sea level rise rate, so they don't have to spend so much on raising the heights of flood defences. So it's really nasty and evil, but you can see the temptation for the people who oversee the IPCC reports. That's government people have an input after the scientists have said what they want to say. The summary that goes to policymakers is overseen by politicians, and they tend to weaken the predictions. So that the worst case of this was sea level rise, and the IPCC was predicting in 2007 something like 30 centimetres of sea level rise by the end of the century. So that went out to policymakers. They thought, oh great, we don't have to do that much. We can just raise the heights of flood defences by
about
30 centimetres. Yeah. But then the last assessment, they took account of the fact that the Greenland ice sheet and Antarctic ice sheet are melting at an accelerated rate. And we now know how fast they're melting, because there's a satellite now, a gravity-based satellite, which measures how much stuff there is underneath it. So as the Greenland ice sheet shrinks, it's possible to exactly map how much ice there is left in Greenland. So that's called the GRACE satellite. It's a wonderful thing. And we now know that Greenland is losing mass at about 300 cubic kilometres a year, and Antarctica is starting to lose mass. It's up to about 100. And that's greater than any other source of water going into the ocean. All the other glaciers in the world are already retreating, and most of them are going. And the warming of the ocean doesn't do that much. It's Greenland and Antarctica that are now the drivers of sea level rise. And the more we measure processes in Greenland, the more we conclude that sea level is rising in an accelerated way, because the melt of the Greenland ice sheet is accelerating. So the warming of Greenland, giving accelerated loss of ice from the surface in the summer, gives you accelerated deposition of fresh water into the ocean, gives you accelerated sea level rise. And so it's again a feedback loop. And there's no way, it's not easy to get around it. Many people think, well, if we can deal with global warming and stop the rate of warming, then that stops sea level rise as well. But it doesn't. The sea level rise is partly based, because you're dealing with very thick ice sheets, there's a flywheel effect going on, that once the melt of Greenland gets going, it doesn't matter if we stop global warming, it'll take a long time before the melt of Greenland stops happening, the melt of Antarctica. So the sea level, accelerating sea level rise, will keep on going even if we deal with air temperatures.
So, right.
And the problems there, of course, are loss of coastal cities, because this 30 centimetres has already gone to a metre, and now a lot of glaciologists think it will go to 2, 3, or 4 metres as the sea level rises.
By 2100 or so.
Yes, by 2100.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that would be pretty catastrophic. We lose a lot of coastal cities completely. And again, because sea level is global, it's not regional. You're not going to save one place like Miami is trying to save itself by pumping water out to sea, which is a bit like King Canute.
And also higher, presumably, if that higher sea level is a global average across an entire planet, when it surges, when you've got more energy anyway, and hurricanes start whipping it up, presumably you've got a bunch more water to surge with. So those surges across cities are going to be a whole lot more dramatic as well, presumably.
And I think that's going to be the worst effect. I mean, there was a lot of studies done on storm surges after 1953 floods in the Netherlands and Britain. And I know about that because, first of all, I was alive. And secondly, my grandparents' house was flooded.
Really?
In Tilbury. Oh. And when you look at the sea level rise associated with that, it was a storm surge in the North Sea with a very strong northerly wind just piling water up into the Straits of Dover at a time when it was high tide, and so the water just spilled over. Mm. That kind of thing keeps happening, but if it's happening on the basis of a higher average level, then everything is worse. So the only way to stop things being worse is to raise the heights of seawalls around the entire planet to the same amount as the rise in sea level. So that's why it's very important that we get the rise in sea level right, get the predictions right, because that's how much we've got to raise sea walls.
So we build once rather than continually.
Yes. So I think the planning for London is quite good. They've got contingency plans for building another Thames barrier downstream. Mm-hmm. And I talked to the person, in fact, I went to a meeting in China with the Chinese Academy of Sciences, which had a British delegation, including the guy who's responsible for the Thames barrier. And the Chinese delegation that was really worried because they were using low values for sea level rise, and places like Shanghai, which is full of canals, they didn't know how much they had to raise the heights of canal walls. Even Britain isn't okay. And certainly a place that hasn't got any sea walls, like Bangladesh, is in a terrible state.
Yes.
It's poor. There's, I think, 20 million people live within two metres of sea level.
Right.
As sea level rises, and also you get storm surges in the Bay of Bengal with the wind driving water up into the head of the bay, you get a storm surge. If you have a higher sea level, you get more flooding. So you get catastrophic floods, you already do, around Bangladesh coastline. And people can't afford to retreat because there's another 20 million people living behind them saying, clear off.
Yeah.
And then they can't raise the heights of sea defences, so they just die. Mm. And the frequency of these catastrophic events is going to go up, and that's probably be the main immediate effect of sea level rise, is going to be increase of deaths in poor countries because of storm surges, and then loss, and then economically that it's going to be loss of cities in rich countries because you can't maintain them against the sea level rise, like New Orleans or Miami. Mm. That these cities will have to be abandoned.
Yeah, that's tragic. And then I suppose the final point on Mr. Trump's analyses of climate, which I think we've established are not exactly accurate, but he's also now saying he's in California now, I think, as we speak, looking at the aftermath of the absolutely devastating wildfires that they are ongoing and showing no sign of letting up. And he's suggesting that it's simply a matter of bad forest management. So I think I know what you're going to say, yes, but I'll be interested to know what your view is.
Because then you can blame that on the Democrats, because the Democrats...
Well, there you go. Yeah.
You have to find somebody to blame for your own failures, basically. That's Trump's infantile view of the world.
Mm.
What used to happen would be that there would always be brush fires because that was a sort of a natural process. But it would catch unawares people who were building themselves isolated houses in the sort of American fashion. But what's happening now is more serious because the brush fire gathers momentum and gathers heat. And overwhelms an actual town. I mean, yeah. And so Trump is completely wrong in saying it's forestry practices, because you're wiping out a town. There's no forest there. It's
yes.
And so this town that's been wiped out, it looks like more than 600 people dead, which is the biggest event ever in California, is an example of the fact that the brush fires are now threatening cities. I mean, they're threatening Malibu. They're probably threat. I mean, I often visit La Jolla, which is where the Scripps Institute of Oceanography is, and that's a fairly small town. And you look inland, and you've got these brush covered mountain slopes, and I think that's threatened. Nobody there seems to be worried about it, but it's a very, not only is it a wealthy town, but it's also the site of a lot of scientific research institutes that would be pretty serious if we lost them.
Yes, yeah, double whammy almost. Mm. Mm.